I'm sorry. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining, and sorry for the delay. We had a little technical difficulty, but we are getting up to speed now. I'm just going to let everybody join in. Our numbers are looking great, so we'll start in just a second. Thank you again for joining. Hello, everybody, again, just to say thank you again for joining. We're just getting our panelists on. Sorry again for the delay, and we will start very soon. Hi, Maria.
Hello. Yeah. Hello, everybody. Robert, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you just great.
Yes.
So, sorry again, everybody. It looks like we are ready to begin. And thank you for everybody for joining. Feel free to use the chat feature. We'll be answering any of your questions as we go through. We're recording the video, so just keep that in mind as we'll post it to our website when we're done. I'm happy to take any questions and thank you again. My name is Robert Cummings. I'm the Academic Administrator for the Supply Chain Management Program. And I will pass it on to Maria to lead us off.
Hello, everybody. Again, we apologize for this short delay. Sometimes the technical elements are not helping as we would like. But anyway, here we are, ready to share with you blended supply chain management. Blended master's program at MIT and in the scale network, and then also ready to talk to you, to discuss to you about your questions, your expectations, and everything. So we have prepared a PowerPoint that we would like to share with you with all the updates, and then we are ready to start. Let me share my PowerPoint here. Yeah. Robert, can you see my PowerPoint?
Yes, excellent.
Perfect. Let me, project in the slide mode. Can you see the slide mode?
Yes, it's in slide mode at the moment.
Perfect, just to check. Okay, so first of all, this is the outline for today. So then we are gonna, show you why to choose MIT, SCM, and also the scale programs linked to MIT. We will show the overview of our program and the curriculum. What is the MIT experience? What do we mean with that? So then we will show some experiences from our alumni and how they perceived all this network at MIT. Professional development, how we can help with your career through the path of the blended master program. Some details about applications, admissions, and also financial aid. And then we can have a Q&A session in order just to solve all your questions. But of course, happy to help and send us your question, not only now, but in whenever you need it for submit your application. Yeah. What is the blended program? So then is a new pathway, right? When we are mixing the non-traditional candidates, and non-traditional means a lot. from the global perspective, from different backgrounds, from different expectations in terms of career path. But again, our main mission is just to develop leaders, global leaders in the area of supply chain management.
And Maria, would you be able to just change the display setting so that it changes, so that we just see the presentation instead of the notes?
Yeah, so let me, yeah, sorry. Let me project, because yeah, I have several, screens here, and this is maybe why, yeah. Let me share again. Can you see now in the presentation?
Yes, perfect, yeah.
Perfect, yeah. So in terms of the innovative education, so then this was this master program, this blended master program in supply chain management was an initiative that was directly led by the president Rafe at MIT in 2018. So this is when in January 2018, the first students arrived in campus in order to pursue this hybrid master's degree. So then another programs at MIT have joined us. We are very happy that they have emulated the structure of the program, the different activities that we are promoting in our program. So we are following what the mode of MIT, learning from MIT is learning from the field. So this is also one of the principles that we are following. Actually, then we are creating different experiential learning activities in order to, activate your learning in different kind of areas. So if you are interested more in leadership, on consultancy, on manufacturing, on the logistics industry, so then again, the idea is just to activate all these different experiences from many different angles with the many different academic activities, and also through the MIT network. That is quite powerful, as we will explain now in a minute. So then, what is the path that you will follow if you enroll in our program? Most of you have already followed this path in the MicroMaster. So then you will be, typically here, right? Then just to apply to the blended master program. And then in these 5 months residential, we mean that is on campus experience, you will be able to get the MIT degree. So then and at the end, you will be able to, activate all the network after graduation, as we will explain in a minute. So these are like the most important facts that we would like to highlight today. So then typically you will enroll in a class of 40 experts, experts with experience in the field. Typically our average is 8 years of SCM experience that they will share from many different industries, many different angles. We are very proud that we are ranked number one worldwide in a supply chain and logistics master program, as we will present in a minute. MIT leverage on the excellence attitude. This means a lot. This means that we are trying to do our best in whatever kind of circumstance. For example, today's circumstances with the COVID, we are creating different new activities, different experiential learning opportunities that will take advantage of the difficulties of the COVID, but at the same time will create some opportunities. This is the attitude, excellence attitude that MIT is promoting, but also on campus, right? Just to experience all the different networking and interactions within MIT, with another schools, as law in a school, with engineering school, with other master programs. So also you will enroll in a very active and engaged alumni network that is based on more than 750 alumni in top positions, very top positions. So last year we celebrated our 20th anniversary. It means that our alumni has a very long and powerful story. We also work with worldwide companies, all over the industries. that they are promoting and they are recruiting from our class. Yes, we will show in a minute, but we are talking about Google, Apple, Amazon, but also fast-moving consumer goods, logistics, consultancy, etc. Please, Robert, feel free to stop if you want to reinforce something.
Yeah, of course. And I'll be answering some questions live and some questions in the chat so we can just keep it flowing.
Absolutely. Please, I mean, let me know when you want to answer a question or there is a question that is related to the topic. Yeah.
Sure.
So this is the team, right? So I didn't present myself because we were studying a little bit with delay, but then I am the lead of this program, but also I am leading the research here at MIT in digital supply chain transformation. So Robin and myself, we are working together with Josue, that is executive director of the SCM program, leading mainly the residential class, the 10 months class. Then Len will work with you through the program in order to offer career advice. And then he is, managing the alumni relations office. Then we have a very smart and talented team of postdocs, researchers, managers that are helping us from many different angles, not only here, but at the Center for Transportation and Logistics. So we belong to this center. You will work, for example, a lot with Justin in together with learning career development. Bonnie is here with us too. She's helping with all the marketing and communications aligned with MIT and CTL. So yeah, it's a very helpful network and team that will allow you to navigate through this very great experience. So we are within the MIT Global Scale Network. Then we have different centers that are also offering the blended master program. So Zaragoza Logistics Center, they also offer the blended master program is the similar pattern. So then again, the Micromaster, the beginning, and then they will join us here in January at MIT. And from February till the graduation milestone, then the students will stay in Zaragoza, enjoying all the capstone experience, all the elective experience there together with the residential students that are in Zaragoza. And at MISI also, there is what we call the accelerated program, that is another version of blended program. So then please feel free to link on scale.mit.edu or feel free to send us emails that then we will connect with all the centers and we will solve all the questions. So at the end, the scale is a network of 6 different centers all over the world that are connected from many different angles. So we have more than 10 educational programs, not only the residential master programs, not only the blended, but other, for example, the executive programs that are customized to the industry and to the culture and global and local situations, global local circumstances in each of the regions. Each center has their own network of partners, but also we share some of the partners as the scale corporate partnerships. And then you will enjoy an expanded network of students and an expanded network of alums all over the world that will also help you in finding good connections with companies in other countries, in other areas, in other industry, which is really, really rich. So in terms of the program overview, go step by step. So of course you have finished your MicroMaster certificate. Congratulations for that. It was a very important achievement. Then the next step will be for you to apply now. You know that the deadline is May 1st. But then once you will be accepted and then you will start the enrollment. So then typically in August, we start the activity with the accepted students. So then what we will launch what we call the pre-work in the fall term, the pre-work period. It means that then you will start taking some online courses, for example, the edX Python course. Then we will begin the research project remotely. So typically you will work in a team of one or two students with one or two advisors and one company in order to solve a real problem that will come from your own proposal, could come also from our side, from the researchers, the team of researchers, or also from the companies that are partners of MIT CTL. So you will work with your team, with the company during this fall term. We will have different milestones for the assignments and deliverables. And then we will run some webinars in order to navigate through all this pattern of work. And then the next step will be after Christmas, the IEP. So then you join us physically at MIT on campus. So then please don't interpret that this program will start in January. Actually, we start in August, right? With the capstone project or with the research project and with some other different webinars and activities, right? But it's true that physically you will start join us. We will meet physically in January here at MIT, what we call the IEP period, right? So then it means that we will have our orientation on campus. So it's typically 1 week of different kind of activities. They will have different seminars, different courses in communication. We will have also, for example, the analytical exam. We will then join a 3 weeks period, what we call the Scale Connect. So all the students from all over the Scale network will join us physically here is typically the second week of January. And then we will run different activities in order to enhance in the networking, a very high level of engagement and motivation with a lot of, VPs from all over the world, from very relevant companies in supply chain management. And at the end of this period, we will have what we call Research Expo. So all the progress you have had with your project that you started actually the mid end of August, then you will defend the status, the current progress at the end of January in what we call the Research Expo. So all the students from all over the scale will present their work in front of companies, in front of associations, in front of different potential recruiters, in front of your faculty, researchers coming from all over the scale network. Then, starting in February, we'll have the spring term. So then you will decide your electives, right? So then depending if you are more interested in leadership kind of classes, then you can take, for example, some courses at Sloan, or maybe you are interested more in the analytical content, then you can emphasize more on this kind of knowledge. So then in more than 20 options in terms of electives, you will be able to design your own curriculum. Of course, we will advise how better match all the different electives in order to have a very strong curriculum according to your motivations, right? So we will have the study track typically in March. Then we will go typically to the Bay Area or to Seattle, or some other students, they go to Panama in order to visit companies, to network also with the alumni group there in that particular areas. Also, the career coaching activities will be more intensive during this spring term. So then you will have mock interviews. You will organize interviews. We will help you with that organization. Then we will promote some positions. So then, again, the idea is just to make your career advance, especially through the spring term. And then you will work in the research project, something that you started in August, and then you will continue till end of May, when you will present your final result in another event that is also similar to Research Expo, that will allow you just to connect again with a broader, a group of industries at the end of the term. And finally, you will graduate, right? So you will graduate, you will get your degree, and then there is also interesting all the different activities for the post program. So we work a lot with our alumni network. We invite the network to different events that we organize here. We make the connections. We have also different alumni events in the different big locations. Yeah, and also we continue providing career advice on for you. Okay, so we have two options in terms of the master degree. So we have the Master of Applied Science in Supply Chain Management. So this is our main core of the program. So it's designed for students who want to take a job in industry or in consultancy upon graduation. So then it's mainly focused on the career in industry, but also for some of the students that are more interested and more prepared in doing more research careers. Then we promote the Master of Engineering Supply Chain Management. So the difference between the two of them is a research project. So, and some, differences in the courses, but minor differences. So here in Master of Applied Science, the students follow a capstone project, while in the Master of Engineering path, the students follow a thesis, right? That this, the idea is just to have more focus, more impact on the research area. So this is the curriculum. So then again, I repeat, the MicroMaster, you already took it. So then the pre-work, and these are the subjects that you will take in IAP in January, as I already mentioned. And here are the typical subjects that you will take during the spring term. So we will have a group of electives in supply chain management. We have another group of electives of analysis, and we have another group of electives in management. But again, this will mean 90 units in total. Typically, our students take more than these 90 units. These are the number of units that are required for graduation. But of course, if you want to take more, and then we will advise you how to reach a higher number of credits in order to take as much as you can from the MIT experience. Research project. So research project typically is, there are different paths to follow in the research project. It's a way of creating an additional experiential learning through working on a particular problem, on a particular setting with a particular data, right? So this is one example about a research project that was conducted last year. Actually, it was the one that was awarded in our competition at the end of the academic year. So in this case, they were running a comparative of drone delivery systems in last mile delivery. So in this case, this was based on together with a research group here at MIT CTL, just analyzing, as you can see here, different scenarios, different models of how is what is the best combination between drones and track in order to deploy the last mile delivery in different kind of settings, in different kind of scenarios. So they were running actually a cloud-based solution using mimetic algorithm, and then they implemented in different platforms. That this is one screen about the application that they develop in order to run the different scenarios, right? Just for you to know that this is the this is one setting. Another potential setting, instead of working with the researchers, will be working with your research proposal, the proposal that you are going to submit in your application. So then this is why, we are expecting you to bring the best research proposal in terms of what? In terms of innovative concepts, in terms of bringing realistic data bring in research questions that will allow you just to learn and to experiment with the knowledge that you are going to gather through our program. And also, then typically we like those proposals that bring a real partner, a company that will take advantage of the solution that you are gonna propose, right? Sometimes it comes from your the company you are working in. Sometimes you are bringing a company that is interested in your idea. But typically, yeah, this is something that is proposed at the very beginning in the proposal. So not always this is possible. In some cases, some students bring ideas that are not mature enough. So in that cases, then these proposals are not filtered before starting, I mean, before August, once, of course, the student is accepted. And then we will manage the allocation of projects to the different set of students, right? So yeah, it's typically this is
Maria, and I just wanted that sort of answers a question that we have from our audience. The projects that we assign, so there was a few questions related to the research proposal and how that works out. So yes, the projects are assigned both projects that are brought in by incoming students and from our research partners and from our CTL corporate partners as well. So it's a very, it's a mix of possibilities. But the project itself is still a requirement for the application, both to assess your ability to synthesize a proposal, but also with the possibility that it could be fully fleshed out and elevated to your project that you would work on.
Yeah, typically you work in with another mate in a team of two students. In some cases, we could have only one student, right? So it depends, it will be case by case. In some cases, you will get one advisor. In other cases, you can get two advisors, right? Because it depends more on the particular features of a project. Typically, the advisors will be allocated depending on their expertise, that needs in terms of advisor in that particular context of that particular project and problem. Yeah, but we will elaborate a little bit more later in one of the slides. Yeah. Okay, so the MIT experiences. I love these pictures because also this picture, you see that this is one of my favorite pictures of MIT. We have the dome here, right? We have the river that brings a lot of energy, and we have the city and in another side of the river. So yeah, Boston is a great city to experience because the talent network is, the possibilities are huge, right? So then you can connect with very special people here. So, and these are different pictures of the of MIT, right? So here are in terms of the sport facilities that are providing a lot of opportunities for having a very healthy life here on campus. Also through this bridge, we are connected with downtown and also here, right? So then the spring term is a beautiful term here in New England. So then it's a great opportunity also to enjoy. Here, MIT community, MIT culture is very entrepreneur by nature. So then the way of thinking is different than in other places. And also we promote this way of thinking of challenging ideas all the time, right? We were joking with this COVID situation that with our current students that we challenge ideas, we challenge situations, but we didn't expect to these very challenging times with in front of the COVID. So another opportunity for learning. This is how we are, envisioning these particular circumstances that are really tough, really difficult, but there's another opportunity for learning from that. Yeah. Okay, so why to choose MIT? So I'm going to try to speed up, right? Because then I don't want to delay more. So yeah, there are different facts about how MIT is one of the best institutions, if not the best, all over the world. But for example, if we are taking the QS rank, we have been number one world's university. Several years in a row, we have a high number of Nobel laureates. And especially, I like this fact. So MIT, in terms of the global impact, we are creating the 10th largest GDP in the world based on the network the alumni has created. So this is the impact in terms of value, even in terms of economic value, is huge. So then you will enter in this particular network that then you can leverage for your life. So also in terms of recommendation from our students, so the medium is really high. So then typically you value a lot the experience when you finish. In terms of the blended experience, so of course there are key factors. You are minimal time away from your work, right? It's very intensive. Also is a reduced cost compared with the residential program. Residential master degree, and also these are the top factors of importance for selecting our blended program, right? The most important one is in terms of you guys, in terms of the alumni, is the academic reputation of the department. So this is an important responsibility here from our side that we need to give our best in everything that we do, right? In terms of research, in terms of the academic, in terms of the classes, the lectures, everything. And there are other factors, for example, the culture or community of the department, the range of research opportunities, right? And here, yeah, I have highlighted that also our SCM program is ranked number one by Edu Universal in terms of the master rankings in supply chain and logistics. It's another factor that you should consider for enrolling in our program. Yeah. So this is our class of 2020, just for giving you a rough, image. So 39 enrolling students that are working together with our 44 SCM residential students. Most of them are coming, as you can see here, from engineering, right? More than 50%. And if we include business, so it's almost 75%. Yeah. So very diverse background coming from a multiple number of countries and culture. This is another beauty of our program. Then you will be working with a multicultural background in order to take decisions, in order to understand their perceptions, enrich really, really in high manner, in a high way, the program. Students experience so different pictures about the different kind of things that we are doing. They are having fun. They are creating very strong bonds between the students, but not only in that cohort blended together with the residential. We work a lot in order to create one unique community, but also with the alumni network from past years, but also with the next years, because we are creating continuous bridges. Yeah. So also in terms of a student experience, we have here some of our alumni who are working for example, Daniel in Ahold Delhaize, is a retail chain here in the US as director of supply chain research and development, had in Converse here in Boston, Vicky in Google supply planning manager, or Nate in Adidas, right? For example, just right now we have one of our students got an offer at Apple, another in Google, and a couple of them in Amazon in the last couple of weeks, right? It's a very active network. Yeah. In terms of professional development, so then you will get some service for advance your career with us prior to arrival on campus. So during the fall terms, we are working together with Len Morrison in terms of just to review your resume and your cover letter. Then we will start promoting your profile among your network in the resume book in front of recruiters that are coming on campus even in the fall term. We are working on certain assessment tools that will allow us just to do some pre-work for continuing while you are on campus. Then after arrival on campus, so then you will have full access to on-campus services. So then from many different angles, not only focus on recruiting, but on leveraging the network. Career coaching, job search strategy, and interview preparation, info sessions with employers, interviews, the different career advising, and then job posting, not only at SCM, but also at level of MIT. Yeah, this is the employment outcomes. And these are the kind of profiles. You can take a look later if you want to the slides. We are gonna offer a link for the PDF of the slides. But these are the companies, right? So coming from consultancy, coming from retailer, in the chemical industry, in the bottling and the beverage industry, in the electronic industry, we have a very strong relationship with Dell, with Apple, with Amazon. Amazon, they are one of the best recruiters we have here, especially this year.
And Maria, would you be able to comment just a little in terms of comparing the SCMB program to students going on to other programs like an MBA or another SCM? One question was, what's sort of the difference in career outlook?
NDA, what, non-disclosure agreements?
No, MBA.
Oh, sorry, MBA. Yeah, okay. Then this is SCM is a very intensive program, 10 months, right? So then in terms, if we compare, for example, the price of a tuition in one side to the other, definitely return of investment is higher in SEM, because then you spend only, less time in the master program, but in a very intensive. And then we expose during all the time that you are with us, we expose you to particular recruiters coming from all over the world or coming from all over industries. Additionally, the ratio of the advisor, the career advisor is definitely very customized to your profile. So with Len Morrison and Justin, then they customize what you particularly need, right? How is your profile? How you can better sell your story? How you can better shape your strengths? How you can better navigate with your difficulties? What are the particular interests that you want to pursue in terms of industry, in terms of consultancy company versus manufacturing, in terms of new startups versus more mature companies, right? So then this ratio of students compared with students and advisor per student is definitely one strength that you should consider, right? Yeah. So then the return on investment is definitely higher.
And just one question that someone asked here is it possible to work while pursuing the blended program? I think you know the answer to that. Between January and May, we don't recommend working. For international students, we don't authorize it. Because it's an intensive 5-month program, it's just really not possible to balance the two.
No, and then also, once you come here, you want to take as much as advantage as you can for the experience, for the connection, so then it will be the best for you, right? Because then your way of thinking will change, so you need to embrace all the different opportunities while you are here on campus. So definitely, we don't recommend it. Yeah, but typically you can talk with your company and say, can you give me please a 5 months leave, right? Because I will bring with all this additional experience and connection for your company. And also you can bring the research project that you can work together with the researchers here at MIT and also to compare and contrast with other practices in other companies. So I am sure that your company will value a lot this experience. So you, or let us know if you want us to talk to them. Yeah. Is any other question about this?
No, not about that topic. I mean, we have a few questions on the application, so I'll cover those once we get to that point.
Something important to say here, we will reinforce here. There is one important difference between the SCM blended program and SCM residential program. Maybe some of you are going to apply to both programs, or maybe you have already applied to the residential and are planning to apply to the blended program now. So then through the blended program, the program itself is not eligible to OPT, which means that then you will not get authorization to work here at MIT. Typically in the OPT, then you have certain months that you can start working here in the US, right? So then just for international, you need to consider this point of view. So if you are interested in OPT, then we will recommend you to go through the residential program that will start in August on campus, and then the time of graduation will be exactly the same, right? I mean, the end of May, yeah. Do you want to point something here, Robert?
I think
it's important.
Yeah, I think that was a question that some people had asked as well. So.
Yes, yeah, mm-hmm. Okay. So then blended is not eligible to OPT. Please take this into consideration, yeah. But it means that we can, of course, you can continue working in other countries. So maybe if you are already working here, of course, there's no problem at all, yeah. So career outcomes, growth and advancements. I wanted to highlight all these points. Right, so then graduates, when they are returning to previous employees, this is the fact that we have observed. Increase in salary because the talent is really, really valued by your company. Typically, promotions to higher roles and more responsible roles, more challenging roles because you are willing to take these challenges and then apply your experience, greater responsibility, becoming leaders in innovation. This is what we have observed. And innovation is so important now in supply chain. More global reach, right? So then higher positions, expanding also the responsibility in terms of the teams that are reporting to you, to that profiles. Yeah, so these are the facts that we have observed, yeah. Application process. Robert, maybe you want to continue here?
Yeah, so I'll jump in here.
I will continue with the slides, yeah. Mm.
Excellent, yeah. So yeah, we're just covering some of the application requirements. I know this is a question that a few of you have asked. Of course, the number one requirement is your performance on the 5 online MicroMasters courses and the completion of the CFX exam. So you are required to complete all of those as a verified student. In order to apply for SCM. We would definitely recommend that you double check the MicroMasters website for the deadlines to apply. Currently, you have 3 years from the completion of your CFX exam to apply to our program. So that gives you the eligibility. If you just completed the exam this March, 2020, you should have through 2021, 22, and 23. To apply. I know several people have asked just on the validity of the exam, so it extends quite long. In terms of the IELTS and TOEFL, again, this is a very hot question. We know that most TOEFL centers across the world are shut down. I know that TOEFL has just opened up online at-home testing of their TOEFL exam to all countries except for China and Iran. So as of today, the exam is available widely to our knowledge. Of course, we will consider waivers for applicants who have English speaking abilities. The waiver is just put directly into the application with the checkbox. Just make sure you read our guidance so that you're qualified for that. So we understand and we will be a little flexible in terms of the deadline. The research project, as Maria mentioned, two-page proposal. At the time of application, you don't need to have a signed agreement with the company, but it can just be sort of an idea that you're working on. If you are admitted, we would move further on to see how well developed that project can be. So that's not a concern at the application stage. The video statement, also a very important component. This will give you basically a chance to provide a profile on yourself to the admissions committee. Then we have the basic resume, letters of recommendation, and your transcripts. So overall, that completes the whole application package. Several have also asked about our deadline. We'll get to that at the end, but the deadline is set for May 1st. Since we had a quite late deadline to begin with, we don't foresee any disruption due to the COVID-19 outbreak. Of course, if there is some specific scenarios, you're always welcome to email scmb@mit.edu. But at this point, we will keep the deadline at that point.
Robert, one quick comment. Yeah, we will recommend you in the video to be yourself. Try to be natural, right? To be the best of yourself. But we are looking at very natural profiles, right? So this is important, right? Because we observe that in some cases, maybe the video you are trying to be, another person that bring yourself, right? And then for us, it's important to know a little bit more about you. Huh? And also the research project proposal is really important for us. So, read it carefully, prepare it, of course, carefully. We are looking at research proposals that are, mature in terms of the idea, that are very well justified, that brings data, because our program is quite intensive in analytics. So then, show which kind of data you can bring into your project, right? And also innovative ideas that could be realistic. Right, maybe in the setting of your company, or maybe combining different companies, or maybe different industries. Right? Yeah, I wanted to highlight this because I think it's one of the two key elements.
If we want to move to the next slide, and then I'll answer a few other questions just of overall. So just trying to hit through, we have over 30 questions here. I don't know if I'll be able to get to all of them, but just to answer some quick ones. Yes, you can apply to both the blended and residential program. As Maria highlighted, particularly for international students, the one major difference is the blended program is done on campus for 5 months. The residential program with the full 10-month experience, you are eligible for U.S. work authorization. So if that is a major factor, you can sort of weigh those two pieces, but you do are required to apply separately since we'll have separate decisions. In terms of the average range and age of the participants, the blended program is geared towards more mid-level and upper level professionals. So we do have a higher age range for our applicants. So we definitely encourage those of you still sort of in the middle of your career that you can are definitely a great candidate for the blended program. For the residential program, that's geared towards more entry level and early career professionals. Let's see, one more question here. Do I think that it would be a good fit for individuals looking to apply for a PhD afterwards? Well, our program definitely does give you research skills, and particularly the Master of Engineering could be a track that you could further develop into a PhD. We're really geared towards working professionals going into the industry after. Each year, maybe one or two applicants might continue on to another advanced degree. Let's see, in terms of fellowships, I know this was a very hot topic as well. We offer several different types of departmental fellowships, a Scales Scholars Award for those working in the field of logistics and supply chain, blended achievement awards for merit based off of your excellent performance on the exam, and then also trying to reach out to those applicants who are further along in their career and sort of give them that edge to join the program. All of our fellowships are available to both international and domestic students, so it's an option for everybody. There is no additional application required. You just select your interest in the fellowships within the online application, and it'll be taken into consideration with your application. Financial support and aid is a completely separate decision from your admission decision, so that it doesn't impact what our decision will be on your application. It's just an additional incentive.
Yeah, I am showing you right now the four different fellowships and awards that we are promoting. Yeah, so just for you to know that we are providing financial aid. Yeah, you can take a look to the website. Yeah, in order to see all the different features.
Let's see. I think that covers that. Some basic application tips. These are sort of the three things that we highlighted as being the most important for you to focus on. Our application is reviewed holistically with all the components taken into consideration by the admissions committee. But obviously these areas are really directly in your control and have a great influence on the review process. Your video statement gives us an insight into why you want to pursue the program. So it's very important. Your research proposal, because our short duration of the program, just 5 months, we want to make sure you have those research skills available to you so that you can really hit the ground running during the pre-work phase and once you come on campus. And then obviously the grades and your work experience are a high marker of achievement, which again, the admissions committee weighs heavily.
Yeah, there is typically a question if there is a threshold in terms of the grades of CFX and SEX. So there is not a particular threshold. Of course, the higher, the better, because then it's a good signal of your performance. But then we are reviewing all the applications very holistically, right? So then we can understand that we can have a particular difficulty in one of the SEX exams, right? So then it's not that we is a threshold in order to cut and then beyond, no, this is not the idea. It's we review holistically. We are taking into consideration the years of experience in supply chain management, but also in which kind of area field and then which kind of growth you have had so far, what you can bring into the class in terms of your particular feature, right? So then your leadership, your industrial experience. This is why all these tips, all these elements are important, no one over the other. Right, the grades and speed is important, but also how you present your research proposal and what is the idea that you want to bring. And also, I mean, bring yourself in the video. Yeah.
Lots of questions here. What we'll probably do is just at the end, I'll try to go through as many as possible so we can just proceed with the last page here on the application tips.
Yeah, but maybe we can stay some minutes more, right? Because we started a little bit later. So of course, if you have to leave, feel free to leave. But those that want to continue, we can stay a little bit longer here in order to try to answer your questions. We are very happy about your interest, right? Yeah. So then it's a very good signal, yeah.
So if you want to just show the next slide and then I'll start answering the questions here.
Hmm. Yeah,
So our application reminders, just a reminder that, as I mentioned, our deadline is May 1st. We'll turn around decisions within 3 weeks. So now just focusing on some of the questions that we've gotten through, I'll try to pose them as best I can. So in terms of OPT and work authorization, again, our hands are tied in terms of what the US will allow. So as for the blended program, it's just simply not an option. There's no legal status for us to allow you to work in the US. So again, that is sort of beyond our control. If work authorization is something you really are interested in, you'll have to look at the SCM residential program.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. A question just about tuition. I don't have the exact number off the top of my head, but if you visit our website, scm.mit.edu, we'll have the full tuition figures outlined there available.
Yeah, in order to be precise, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Let's see. There was a few questions about deferral. So if you apply, we will always consider deferring applications on a case-by-case basis. We don't have a blanket policy. Obviously, there is still some uncertainty with the COVID-19 outbreak. So we'll consider each person's scenario individually. But if you're looking solely to apply just to get deferred, then it might be best to just wait and apply in the year that you're really ready to take that leap.
There are a lot of questions about research project proposal examples. They are available in the website, right? And then you can take a look, but please don't take only these proposals in your mind. Try to customize your own idea, bring your own way of viewing this particular problem. This is that, so we are looking for your ideas, right? Yeah. Is there any difference between round one and round three in terms of admissions and applications? No, there is no difference, only the timeline, right? So then if you apply the first round and then you got accepted, then you will know earlier that if you apply in the third and you got accepted. But then we are looking at the application exactly in the same way, with the same process. Every single application is reviewed by 5 different people, right? So then, we are applying exactly the same in one round over the other. Typically, we align our deadlines for applications together with the CFX, right? This is our pattern, yeah.
So a few more questions here. If you have a research proposal, but no company data, would that be okay at the application stage? Yes, of course, you can propose that proposal, and then we'll decide.
But we will recommend you. But we will recommend you at least to highlight which kind of data you will need to connect. To collect, right? In order to be able to deploy this particular research project, because we want you to understand how do you envision this particular project and which kind of path you will deploy in order to solve this particular problem, right? Yep. So then be creative also in the kind of data and be realistic, right? Kind of data that there you will be able to gather.
Let's see, in terms of the fellowships available, what percentage do they usually cover? Our fellowships are a small pool of funds, so usually only from 5% up to 25% of your overall tuition. So it's just a number that you can keep in mind. We try to make it available to as many students as possible as well.
But also you need to view this point of view like a long investment, right? So then you spend in the tuition, but then you will get the opportunities to expand your career and your network and your salary, right? So then the return of investment is what you need to take into account and all the short-term investment for this month.
There's a few more questions just about waiver scenarios for individual documents. If you have any concerns about your TOEFL exam, recommendation letters, or transcrips, just email scmb@mit.edu and we can work out what will work best for you.
Yeah.
In terms of the number of application rounds that we have each year, since we're only going into our fourth year now, we haven't had sort of a fully stable model yet. We are at this point are aiming to have one admissions round at the end of each CFX exam. So that is why we have two this year, which align with the two CFX exams.
So what would you recommend you, if you imagine that you are in the middle of the MicroMaster, let's say in SC3X, so we recommend you just to prepare your application with time in advance, right? That you will follow the SC4 and the CFX, but preparing the application with time in advance, because then typically we are just after the CFX, right? So then as better you prepare, more mature application, you will be able to submit, right?
Let's see, a few more questions here. How long after you finish the MicroMasters do you have to apply to the blended program? I mentioned earlier, it expires after 3 years, so just keep that in mind after you complete the CFX.
So there's a question about the current COVID-19 outbreak, and I wanted to bring it here, right? Of course, all the world, this is a global crisis is happening, right? So then all the universities are dealing with that. I can't tell you what we are doing here at MIT. We have created new courses about the COVID. We have created new projects. For example, we are working with UNICEF. And then our students are having direct impact on the UNICEF operations in front of the COVID. We are bringing experts, not only from the humanitarian side, but also how the big executives in supply chain leading roles, how they are dealing with all this disruption. And what we have observed is supply chain management is a key role in dealing with all this disruption in order to develop resilience. So then, I think that the training, the good preparation, good skills in the supply chain roles have been demonstrated that are key in the future in order to face all these challenges, right, in front of the COVID. So then how should we plan for January 2021 in case of a disruption still continues? We don't know what is gonna happen, right? So the scenario that we are hoping is the same as scenario that we were having in the past, right? So then have the fall term online, but this is what we had in the past. And then hopefully the students will join us in January. But to be honest, we cannot create certain answers in that regard because it's totally beyond our control, as you already know. But this is a scenario that we envision, that in January, hopefully everything will be okay. But we need to, of course, we will deploy these scenarios depending on how the situation will progress.
A few more questions here. For the two letters of recommendation, do we recommend that they come from industry or academic? Obviously a mix would be great, one academic, one industry, but given most applicants are outside of work for more of a substantial period of time, we understand two letters of recommendation from industry, from your supervisors, is plenty sufficient.
Yeah, Sebastian Wurtz is asking about family and living here. The MIT facilitates living on campus and also off campus, so it depends on your own interest. So what is the percentage of students that are living on campus, typically, Robert, maybe?
Yeah, for on campus, I would say probably well over 80%. A majority of our students do live on campus. Probably even higher than that. So it is a very on-campus experience, both for residential and blended students.
Yeah, and the facilities are great and are close to the downtown with a lot of different services, opportunities, and sports facilities. So then I will recommend you to take a look because it's really, really exciting. Yeah.
Another question is, when students go on to complete the program, do they usually return to outside companies or do they recruit from other companies in the area? I think we see a mix. Usually up to half the students return to their home company where they've been working. Others seek new opportunities either in their home country or elsewhere.
Yeah, so there's a mix, yeah.
Let's see, when you apply, you can select all the scale centers that you would be interested in. We all have the same deadline of May 1st and we will all send our same decisions on May 22nd. So it just requires that one application.
And then we will encourage you to apply to the different programs in the scale, right? So then there are great opportunities in all the different countries. There are differences between the different programs. Even the curriculum in, for example, Zaragoza and MIT is very similar, but there are a lot of opportunities and strengths in Zaragoza too that then you can also consider. The same in Malaysia, right? They have a particular accelerated program, so they have a very customized program that then you can take advantage of. So we will recommend you to apply to all of them. Yeah. Let us know if you have any question about that. Yeah.
Yeah. And then in terms of the class size of our program, we usually aim for a class of 40 students. We take applicants from both round one and round two, so there's still plenty of space available for this round. We're welcoming as many applicants as we can fit in.
Yeah. And of course, our recommendation will be to apply the sooner the better. If you are thinking about now, next year, so of course, the sooner the better. Once you have all the knowledge fresh in your mind after the MicroMaster, so we will recommend you to apply now. Yeah, let us know, yeah, if you have any question again in terms of the progress of your application. So then GradApply is there. So then we didn't cover that slide, but this is available there in the slide deck.
And this sort of covers a broad scope of questions that maybe Maria, you might be able to weigh in on, is can you speak more just about the work experience that you've seen from our incoming applicants and sort of what background is really suitable to apply?
Yeah, so there are different kind of backgrounds. So then we have some applicants that are coming, for example, from more IT-focused profiles. They want to complement their IT analytics background with more business supply chain approach. There are some others that are coming from pure supply chains and they want to complement with a more analytical knowledge, right, in order to be able to approach digitalization. There are some profiles that are coming from humanitarian, that is the logistics and supply chain is really important, and then they are pursuing their motivations of having an impact in the humanitarian world. We are having, even for example, this year we have the chief supply chain officer of the most important retailer in one country in Latin America. We have VPs that are taking our classes, but also we have experts with 3 years of experience that have a very prominent career in front of them, and they want to also to build on the knowledge they have. What else? We have consultants.
I think that answers one question is, do we only accept people with supply chain experience? So no, there's a broad range of experience.
Yeah, so then send us your application and we will consider, because maybe you think that you are not in the supply chain experience, but maybe, you are, right? So you are connected with the supply chain function, right? Of course, we value previous supply chain experience, right? But then supply chain is very, I mean, broad area of expertise. We have, for example, some experts that are working more on the financial side in a company in the supply chain area, right? So then they can bring a lot of insight into the class. Bring your application and then bring us how do you perceive the connection with supply chain, and then we will review holistically your application.
And just one clarifying question that answers a few is this round deadline for May 1st is for entry in January of 2021. The next CFX takes place in early October of 2020. Yeah. Those applicants will be eligible for the class of 2022. That would be our new admission round for the following class. This year, it's just for 2021.
Yes, yes. One remark here. So imagine that you apply now. Then you submit your application on May the 1st, right? So we will review, and then we will be able to send the decisions as they are here in the slide in May 22nd. So then in that case, we will start working with you, especially with your research proposal, right? In order to get more mature research proposal, in order to filter. So then you will start really working in August of this year, August 2020. Then you will run the fall term, fall 2020 online with the research project, with the advisor, with different online courses. And then you will join us physically on campus in January 2021.
So one question, how many hours per week can somebody expect to be working on the pre-work in the fall?
It depends. I would say that the similar pattern that you did with your MicroMaster, right? So there are some students that they followed a more intensive path in MicroMaster, finishing in 10 months. Some others followed 18 months. So then, I would say that if you follow a similar pattern than the MicroMaster, you will be able to fulfill. Of course, there are certain deadlines, right, that then will be higher. And then the closer to coming here, the higher the work, because also you need to prepare a lot of paperwork. Right, in terms of the applications to housing, in terms of submitting for your MIT ID, in terms of your insurance. So then be prepared also to reserve part of your time for preparing your life here in Boston.
Let's see, another question. So that was how many hours? In terms of the job search for those returning to their home country, we still definitely provide career development support through our office and through Len Morrison. But for those returning home, you do have to be a little bit more proactive in building those connections, because obviously we don't have connections all over the world. You have to be a proactive member in that job search, but we're always here to help as well.
And also the MIT alumni is very rich and very engaged, right? So this is one of the assets.
One of the biggest benefits is that the alumni network that we've built together with our SCALE partners and our SCM students. We always say it's the alumni who really drive the recruiting effort. So building those connections is a major component. Another
Can
question.
Can I submit two research proposals? No, you think it's better only one, right? It's enough, Thank you for the engagement.
Let's see. Is there a template? On our website, we provide a few examples, so you can take a look there. It's usually two pages outlining the methodology, the research scope, the question that you're hoping to answer. Are all of the SCALE programs taught in English? Yes, their curriculums are taught in English, and they follow MIT's sort of original outline of courses, so a lot of the similar material is covered. Let's see.
I think that is enough. We have covered most of them, right, Robert?
I think a lot of them are just repeating from earlier. So like we said, we will post the slides and the presentation on our website so you can follow up. And then of course, if you have any follow-up questions, you can email scmb@mit.edu. Maria and I will be happy to answer any additional questions.
especially now that we are aware that you may have more questions since the deadline is closer, but feel free to reach to us. And again, apologize for the delay when we started, but I think that we have had a very interesting, a very, engaged and interactive, webinar. So yep. Thank you very much to all of you for your attendance, your time. Feel free to reach to us. And thank you, Bonnie, that you are also there. And thank you, Robert, for being here with our prospects. Have a beautiful day.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.